to share with you this episode where I talked to my good friend Kimberly Simms in Atlanta. We catch up at the Sundial, which is that restaurant that rotates in Atlanta at the top of the Westin. It's one of my favorite places on the planet. I don't have enough money to eat there, but whenever I'm in town, sometimes I drink a cup of coffee and watch the world rotate. But Kim and I talk about whether art is therapy or not. And we discuss her residency at the Carl Sandburg home. And we've probably known each other from a past life because she was friends with my oldest brother, who's 10 years older than me. So just to put that in context, when I was 9, Kim was chilling with the older version of me, also known as my brother, when he was 19 and she was about 19. And then I came into the picture 10 years later when I started making some noise in the spoken word world in Greenville. And we talk about that and we catch up, and I'm super excited to share this with you. Also, she has a brand new book coming out under Finishing Line Press. I know she's super excited about that, and I want you to run out there and click buttons. Click those buttons for the pledge drive. I feel like I'm listening to NPR during their pledge drive. And if you guys don't give a penny a day, we're going to lose our programming and the robots are going to take over and turn all the art into cashew milk, which is their fuel. Cashew milk curdles, by the way. I found that out this morning as I threw it in some coffee. I was very disappointed, and I had to chug the whole thing. And it felt like an Irish car bomb in the morning. And I guess that's a great way to start tour. I guess let's get this cashew milk curdle going. But again, this is Miss Kimberly Simms, founder of Wits End Poetry, a nonprofit that does amazing work. I'm super excited to catch up with her and grateful to share this conversation with you. All the love. Thanks for listening. Bye. Hey, everybody. Welcome to Groundwater. This is Jonathan Brown with Kimberly Simms. Hi, Kim.
Hi. How are you?
I'm amazing now that I have this muffin in front of me.
I know. This stuff looks awesome.
Yeah.
Beautiful, beautiful place to be here at the Westin, overlooking the fabulous Atlanta. Go Falcons and all that good stuff.
We're in Atlanta.
It's Super Bowl.
On the day of the Super Bowl, at the top of a restaurant that rotates. And we're about to talk about stuff. So you're in Atlanta. You used to be in Greenville.
Yes. I moved here in August, although I'm still doing quite a bit of back and forth.
Okay.
Being involved with things like doing some residencies and helping still with Sunday nights, Coffee in the Ground, witsendpoetry.com. Still doing all that good
stuff. Watch out. Yeah, tell me about that, because Coffee Underground is, I'm 34, I think I was 18 the first time I ever touched a mic, and it was at Coffee Underground, and I'm pretty sure you were hosting. How long has that been running?
14 years, since we started in 2002.
Did I do the math right?
I don't know.
Maybe I wasn't 18. Maybe I was 20. I don't know. I do know that's the first time I ever touched a mic.
And I was young.
No.
We were young, and it was awesome.
And it was beautiful and gorgeous, and it meant something.
We had a fabulous time.
So that's been going for, you said 14 years?
14 years.
And you were actively hosting it for a long time, but now you've kind of delegated it a little?
When I had my daughter, then Moody Black took over hosting on Sunday nights. I still do host 5 or 6, 7 times a year.
Okay.
I still do all the booking and keep up the website. It's my little baby. I cannot abandon it.
How long, and has Wits End been going as long as Coffee Underground? Or
Wits End Poetry became an official nonprofit in 2004.
Yeah.
When I hosted the first ever World Poetry Slam in Greenville, South Carolina.
Stop it.
Which you were a finalist in.
That's the
Jonathan Brown.
Only final stage I ever made. I thought I was way out of my league.
And
I was
like, Taylor Molly hosted that finals, mm-hmm. and that was fabulous.
Right.
Because he's so amazing.
Yeah.
And that was a really good time, and I think that really, A, launched a fabulous event that is still going, and touring to different cities,
right.
but also just really got Greenville excited about Poetry Slam, and I think it really helped launch our movement
yeah.
in the Carolinas, kind of took everything to the next level.
Oh, it definitely did.
You know?
It definitely did. Do you have, you've been running this thing for so long, and the founder of a nonprofit that is a 501c3, mm-hmm. Wits End Poetry, and then Coffee Underground, so those are like connected and kind of work off each other. Do you have any advice for someone who wanted to start an arts organization? Because you did it. How do you do it?
I mean, basically, you know, I did all the paperwork myself. I did not
okay.
hire a lawyer. I did not hire an accountant. I just... The IRS are very helpful, actually, because
okay.
I think that they can actually tell when you're, like, a real person trying to do something cool as opposed to...
Wow.
You know, because I sent in the application, and the guy called me, and he's like, well, you need to tweak a few things, and we did, and he talked to me, and I tweaked a few things and sent it back in, and...
Yeah.
You know, and then... You know, at first you just have provisionary status for like 4 years, and then you have to fill out more paperwork, and we did all that, and...
And then you become
and then,
the yeah, official.
Yep, so 12 years? But we did decide to keep it small. There was a point when I said, do I want to be a full-time executive director, or do I want to be a poet and just have this be fun? So we did not try to make it... bigger than it needed to be, and I think that's a kind of a common pitfall that people think, I started a nonprofit, I need to make huge. But if you make something huge, you have to fund it, and then all you're doing is looking for funding, and you're not focusing on the purpose of the nonprofit anymore.
Okay.
And for us, our purpose was to help writers make a living as writers by actually paying them to do featured shows.
Okay. This is a good goal.
And also to coach writers in their careers,
yeah.
to coach poets in their performances through our Slam Team program, and just basically be a resource to up-and-coming writers in our area, and also to inspire the people in our community by bringing touring poets to the little town
yeah.
of Greenville, South Carolina.
Which you guys do a really good job of, by the way. I think
Thank
Coffee Underground is like... It's one of my favorite places to feature beyond the emotional connection I have to it. I mean, like, you have a great audience and you pay well.
And it's fun. And what's really cool now is that we're actually... We're close to having overgrown the venue.
Yeah,
like, I had... I mean, I would say 75% of the time we're at capacity.
Mm-hmm.
5 or 6 times a year I have to tell people, I'm sorry, we are sold out. We don't have it. We brought in all the chairs we can find. People are standing up. We simply
right.
cannot let any more people into this venue. And that's an amazing problem to have at a poetry event. And part of
yeah.
it, I think, is just the consistency.
Because it's been every... single
Sunday for 14 years. People know it's there and it's happening. But we still have new people every week, and I think that's exciting.
Yeah. Especially in a city where, I mean, Greenville's a lot of fun, but the Handlebar closed down. Some other music venues have shut down.
And Coffee Underground is locally owned
right.
by a Greenville person. They make their own coffee there, and... So for me, it's important for me and my personal outlook to be supporting a local business
yeah.
as we're supporting local poets. And I think also that's been what's made it so successful is having a good relationship with Dana, the owner, is just awesome. And
yeah.
she's just been so supportive. It's been
yeah.
mutually beneficial, I think, for both of us.
Okay. Can I ask you about one of your? I want to ask you about one of your poems. You have this piece about Mae Jameson.
Yes.
Right, and it's sort of in this piece. If I can, let me just jump out and make a bunch of assumptions here. You take kind of a journalistic approach.
It includes a lot of research and facts about Mae Jameson.
Yeah. And not, I don't want to like summarize the poem or the poet or the subject matter, because that wouldn't do it any justice, and I think people should experience the piece of art by themselves. But can you talk about the process of researching Mae Jameson?
Actually, what's really interesting about that poem is that's a poem that I use as a model a lot when I'm working with middle school, high school, and elementary school kids, because writing tribute poems is such a beautiful thing to do, particularly for young people who've not had that much life experience yet. Sure. And I think the amazing thing about writing a tribute poem is sometimes you can say things about yourself through the voice of a character, and I think that can be really powerful. For any writer, because it kind of frees you up. If you find a well-known person that you research and you find that they've had some similar life experiences to you,
you
can then kind of draw on some of your own emotions and own feelings, but in the guise of this other character. And I think that's why persona poems are awesome. I write tons of persona poems or tribute poems, and I love that format. The Mae Jameson poem was really great because I have just so much admiration for her. She grew up in Alabama in a small town. Her parents, she was born in 1956, and so when she was born, Jim Crow was happening. There's still segregation. Her parents moved to Chicago. Her mom was a school teacher, actually. And just through that family support, went from being a girl in Alabama to being the first African-American woman in space. But not only that, she got a full scholarship to Stanford.
Okay.
I mean, yeah, she's so awesome. She's so amazing, and she's still a doctor today. I mean, I like to write poems about, it's fun to write stuff about people who are still alive sometimes.
Yeah.
But the poem tries to combine being informative, but also starting with a lot of figurative language, because the poem starts, hang on, let me see if I can, on the spot here, remember how the poem starts. My blood pumps itself to a distant planet. My brain is a supernova. My skin is a million stars. It's the beginning of the poem. And just kind of focuses on what would it be like to sit in the shuttle waiting to blast off into space, and how you would remember all the things that led up to that moment. And then knowing that you're changing history, so you're not leaving something amazing and exciting.
Yes, absolutely. Thank you. This looks great. Oh my god, it smells so good.
Yay, our lunch is here.
Oh my god.
Fabulous.
Let's pause for a second, and I just want to know, what did you get? What is in front of you now?
The grilled salmon on a salad.
Oh my god.
Which looks delicious.
It looks really good.
That looks awesome. Is that barbecue and eggs?
It smells really good, too.
Oh, my gosh, with the awesome sauce on it.
Barbecue, hollandaise, biscuit action.
So good.
Like, I almost feel like we should pause it and have some bites.
Let's take a break.
All right, we're going to pause it, and we're going to have some bites, and we'll be back. Okay. So we just had an amazing brunch, and now we're back. We're back. So we were talking about Mae Jameson and this notion of like non-fictioning a poem. Do you see yourself doing more of that work in the future?
I do, and I actually do have other poems where this concept is you take something historical and real,
okay,
and you turn it into something fictional. And poetry. And actually, my new collection of poems about the textile mills is probably a pretty big example of that.
Okay.
Where I did lots of family interviews, lots of research about what life was like across the Carolinas and Georgia, 1910, 1920s, 1930s, even towards war, and then synthesized all that family history and interviews and newspapers I read from that time period into 40 poems.
Oh.
To 40 poems.
So your new book is, what is the title of it?
Lindy Lee, Songs on Mill Hill.
And when will it be out?
Still in some negotiations right now, so it'll probably be out in the summer or fall.
Summer or fall.
Some point in 2017. Somewhere in there.
Okay.
Which is pretty exciting.
And can I ask who published it?
Not at this time.
Okay. That's fair. No, I only ask because, and you know this.
It is a traditional publisher.
Well, I would hate to think anything different. There can be a stigma against, hey, I just stapled this together and showed up at the open mic. What's your name? Like, self-publishing can look real bad.
It can be, in some people's eyes. It can be good. I mean, I love some of the self-published books.
You want? Sorry for interrupting.
Oh, yeah. We're going to need the key lime pie.
Key lime tart?
Yeah.
And I'm good. Thank you.
I'll bring an extra spoon.
Thank you so much.
We don't.
Okay.
Well, actually, let me look in the back. Sometimes we'll get... I got you. Do you have a preference of...
Whatever non-dairy variety that's back
there.
Thank
you. I love it.
I mean, I own a lot of self-published books, and they're fabulous. But there is a stigma as far as where you can then physically go to get reading for that. And okay. I was very close to being like, this is taking too long. I wanted to self-publish this book.
That's how I felt about my MFA thesis.
Because it is a extremely arduous and long process.
Yeah.
The positive thing is... I have 11 of the poems from the collection are already published in other academic journals.
Yeah.
Some of them have won awards.
Yeah.
A couple of honorable mentions. They got first place in New York County Arts Council. I got my Carl Sandburg Writer-in-Residence gig from the Lindy Lee poems. So they've taken me a lot of places while I've been waiting for a publisher to pick them up. And now, finally, a publisher has picked them up, but it was a very long, slow, painful...
It takes a lot of patience.
...expensive process, because those chapbook contests...
Well, if there's any balance in the universe, I'm sure it'll pay off, because you put
a
lot into
it. It will. It absolutely will. I know that it will. But that is to say, that's why self-publishing is quite attractive in some ways, because... You do make more money off your book that way.
Yeah, you do. And when when you gig super hard, like, it's kind of important that you have them in front of you.
Yes.
To give them to other people in exchange for money.
Yes. In a fast, timely manner.
Fast, quick, dirty.
So.
It works.
Plus
so that reminds me, quick story. I was in Prague studying.
Love Prague.
Love Prague.
Love Prague.
Jesus, we are white girls at brunch right now. So I'm in Europe. Studying with David St. John and Christopher Buckley. And Christopher Buckley is talking about the publishing process. And this kid, I say kid, but I think he was in graduate school, asked Christopher Buckley, should I send this out? Do you think it's good enough to send out? And Christopher Buckley said, yeah, you should send it out to your mom. She might want to read it.
Yes.
Bless his heart. Bless his heart. Well, it's funny, this kind of like
little poet soldier.
This validation of art, right? It's almost like, I mean, retweeting is the same way. If you're like, hey guys, just wrote a song, you should listen to it. You kind of sound like a fifth grader saying, mom, look at me, look at me. But if you say, hey, Jonathan just wrote this song, y'all should listen to it. It somehow has just a little more credibility
than
if I said it. And then if an outside entity, a third party who doesn't know either of us, blesses the art.
Yes.
Now it has even more credibility.
Yes.
I guess. I don't know.
I think that's part of it. It's just an outside entity validating what you're doing. In a very slow, long game process.
Yeah.
Which is very exciting when it finally pays off.
I'm sure, I know. I know it is. I got frustrated with the idea of gatekeepers and that I have to ask anybody else if I'm good enough. I'm gonna self-help this thing and say that I'm good enough.
Yeah. No, you got to.
But I also see how...
You have to believe in yourself.
Getting a cosign from an outside entity is valuable, whether it be in music or in poetry.
I think you have to balance those two things.
Yeah.
I think you have to keep moving forward, you know, while you're sending things out and it taking on years. You have to keep moving forward with your art and keep doing things and keep pushing and just never stop. Always stay in motion. And I think that process of always being in motion as a writer and always trying to figure out what the next thing is what gives you longevity. And over time, all those things that you've been doing start adding up into something that means something to the gatekeepers.
Yeah.
Does that make sense?
It does. It does. And it makes good sense. Speaking of gatekeepers, there's a wonderful person in Massachusetts. She goes to Mount Holyoke College. And she, her name is, I'm going to butcher her name, Aisha Balabas. Okay. Saying it wrong. I apologize. Aisha. Damn it. So she asked me this super awesome question that I wanted to ask you. And it's like, within our current political climate, is art now more important than it's ever been? Or is art now more irrelevant than it's ever been? Because if science isn't important anymore, and if facts are kind of out the window, how does art fit into the conversation of meaning for the sort of the everyday person?
I think that art always has the same impact in that, you know, we get up every day and we go to work and we do all these very tedious things. And art is what gives our lives meaning. It helps us explore what is the human experience and it helps us to connect with other people. I think art, poetry, writing is always extremely important. And I think that if people think that art's not important, they maybe have just not seen the right art. Kind of like with poetry.
Okay.
If you don't think you've liked poetry, you don't think you like poetry, but you've only read 5 poems in your life, then that would be like saying, I hate music, and I've only ever listened to Mozart.
Thank you.
But I do think that poetry, particularly open mics, particularly spoken word events, is going to be a great outlet for people to get together with like-minded people in places where there's not alternate facts. And
because we make our own,
share their alternate facts, and
art has a lot to do with alternate facts if you think about it.
Like, it does.
Maybe we could get along with the alternate facts people because we make stuff up all the time and then act like it's true.
Right. We'll call it fiction.
Maybe we're closer than we think we are.
Maybe, who knows? But I think it's going to be a good time for writers. I mean, I'm getting ready to dust off some of those Bush era poems and
just change a couple nouns.
I'm gonna change the name.
Yeah, just change a couple nouns. Your like political Bush poem you wrote 10 years ago is still relevant.
Shady becomes Bannon. It'll
right.
be easy.
It's really easy. Just dust off that old anti-Iraq war poem.
Oh, yeah.
We're gonna go do it again.
Yeah. And direct Iran.
Yeah. That's the saddest thing on
Scary.
The planet. Speaking of, I want to switch gears because that is super sad. Can you talk about the work you do with young people? Because that's not sad. That's awesome.
No, it's so inspiring. Oh my gosh. I was actually just in this middle school last week. And it was awesome because I was feeling the weight of the world is very heavy right now. And when you spend time with super excited, amazing young people, you know that everything in the world is going to turn out just fine because these kids exist. I was over at a middle school for the arts in Greenville, South Carolina, and those kids, we were writing tribute poems.
Okay.
So they did research, and they could pick out their own person. They picked out amazing people. I mean, one kid wrote this poem about Helen Keller and then went home and learned sign language so she could sign part of her poem.
So,
So poetry was like her gateway drug to sign language?
Yeah, it was amazing.
That's kind of awesome.
And it was their gateway drug to poetry slam because we wrote tribute poems that were beautiful and amazing. And then we actually had a poetry slam, and I did some work with them on performance.
Yes.
And, like, it was so wow. Like, I had 75 kids participate in poetry slams in one day.
It sounds overwhelming.
It was beautiful and awesome. And I was so excited about life and the world after that day because I was like, you know what? If these kids are doing these amazing things.
Oh my God.
She won.
All right.
Thank you so much.
Enjoy.
Thank you.
I really appreciate you. Thank you.
Do you have any parking validations or anything?
I
got the filet mignon of parking.
Oh, you do?
I got $20 for 2 hour parking. Oh, it's terrible.
Where did you park?
Across the street.
Wait, do you have the pass with you?
Do you validate the
Hyatt? No, I left it on the hood of the car.
Oh, so it's okay. Gotcha.
It's terrible.
Do you validate the Hyatt?
We do not, actually.
Don't. No.
I should have parked in the Westin.
Yeah, okay, next time. But next time, you know. Yeah. Validate with us and we'll stamp it.
Okay.
Yeah.
That's what's up. Thank you. Now we know. And for the listeners out there, I am drinking a quadruple espresso, and we have a key lime pie in front of us.
It looks
What is this? Is this a feather? Is this white chocolate? What is this thing on top?
It's a piece of art, is what is in front of
us. It's functional, though. That's white chocolate. It's white chocolate. Okay, so let's talk about it. Kids, school, art, slam.
Super fun.
I started with slam. And it's like 04. And I'm slamming in Greenville. I'm feeling
03.
Good.
03. You started in 03. You were on our first slam team in 2003.
Just Cause, Moody Black, Donovan Grant Waddell.
Yep. Fabulous. Amazing team.
I don't know what Donovan's up to right now.
He lives in Atlanta.
Oh, he does?
Yeah, I think he might be a lawyer.
Yeah, I'm sure he's doing something professional.
And
because
awesome.
I invited him to my shows and he didn't come. I'm just kidding.
He does some acting too.
Really?
Mm-hmm.
He's always been a beautiful dude. But I feel like Poetry Slam is a great like introduction to art.
Yes.
And writing and performance, but it's
and
not
theater.
In theater. And directing and
public speaking
and singing and
all these things.
All kinds of fun miming. If you want a career in miming, you can choreograph a poem.
Yes.
I don't care.
Tableau.
But let me go back to what I said. I feel like it's a great introduction.
Yes.
And then we use it as a stepping stone to go other places.
Absolutely.
And you did that a little bit, right? Am I assuming wrong things there?
No.
I don't want to say you started in it, but you existed in it for a good while.
No, I started in it.
Okay.
Because when back in the beginning of time, before there were poetry slams, I did start the first poetry slam in South Carolina, and that actually happened in 1994.
Get out of here.
So that was actually in Charleston.
Where?
And we were
at
the Horse and Cart.
Get out of here.
Where I used to hang out with your brother.
I know.
And
I used to drink there when I was 18. I loved it.
Me too.
I
ran the
Horse and Cart. And I ran the slam. Back when you could have a bar on King Street that you could still have an art.
No. I lived across the street. It was awesome. And we had such a good time. We were certified with Poetry Slam Incorporated.
Okay.
In 1994.
Yeah. And now you have to like cut off your thumbs to do that, right? I'm just kidding.
Yes. Yes, and send them your fingerprints and your firstborn child. No,
okay,
which is good.
It's 94. You're chilling. You're in college. You're young. You're awesome. You're loud. You're making poetry
slams.
Being
young.
And then it developed into this. So, like, what were some points along the way where you knew I need to transition from X to Y to Z? Like, how did you go from
it's
that
kind of
to this?
It's kind of funny because I think I was always doing what people would call page poetry and slam simultaneously.
Okay.
I was always doing both because I was at College Charleston with the fabulous Paul Allen.
Who I just saw, by the way.
He's awesome. Love
Seth
him.
On his couch. He's doing great.
He's doing so good. And then I came back up and I transferred to Furman just at the same time that Glennis Redman was starting a slam team in Greenville in 1996.
Okay.
So I was on the Greenville 97 and 98 slam teams. And that was fabulous because we won the Southeast Regional Poetry Slam in 98, which was so awesome. And it was fabulous to work with Glennis. She's an amazing coach, and I grew so much as a performer from that experience.
Right.
And that also then led me into working with Gil Allen.
Okay.
Who is probably has had the biggest impact on my writing as a page poet. He writes really funny poems, and he's hilarious, which some people may not know about him. And I like to write funny poems, and I like to write lyric poems, and so we did that together, and he was just great. I mean, I had already taken poetry with Paul Allen, so I couldn't take any more poetry classes. So they let me take independent studies with their two poets there at Furman. So that was like me and Gil Allen meeting once a week and him giving me poetry writing exercises. So it's kind of funny that I've always been doing slam and paid poetry stuff at the same time.
Okay.
But I would say probably in 05, I went to get my master's degree from Clemson University.
Yeah.
And that's probably when I started being like, okay,
let's get serious.
I gotta get serious about this.
I'm gonna write some grown-up poems.
And so I wrote some grown-up poems.
Yeah. And you had that book Quintet came out, right?
Yes. Furman University published 15 of my poems in 03.
Yes. I remember that.
And that was fabulous. I mean, to have Furman University's press publish 15 of my poems was awesome.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, so here in 03, I'm taking my first slam team to the National Poetry Slam with Jonathan Brown on it.
Watch out.
And at the same time, Furman University is publishing 15 of my poems in their academic, from their academic press. So
you're basically a rock star at this point.
Sure, absolutely. Yeah. I will go with that. I'll take it. Take all the things, authors. You know?
Right. So you still kind of navigate both worlds to this day.
Yeah. I like to play in all the places. I don't want to give up slam because I can write really fun poems and just get really silly and get on stage and make a room for people laugh and have a really good time and have all that great camaraderie that you get at an open mic or a poetry slam.
Yeah.
But then I really like to, you know, write some serious poems and
that have images.
With the images and the figurative languages.
Lots of images.
Yeah. And actually, you know, it's funny you asked me about the Mae Jameson poem. I consider that a spoken word piece.
I would, really?
For me, that's a spoken word piece.
Because that thing is tight. Yep. There are no superfluous words in that.
Yep.
So I listened to it a couple times this morning and I was like, whoa. You're crushing it. And it got me inspired about, like, writing a nonfiction piece.
Mm.
Like, I'm fascinated with, like, characters from history. And
there's so many heroes that people don't even, like, you know, people always focus on the same couple people. And I think it's really fun to kind of dig down and into kind of small little history places and pull these heroes out and really... you know, lift them up and kind of learn things about yourself, I think, and inspire yourself and inspire others. Lots of fun.
Can you talk a little bit about the upcoming workshop you have at the Pat Conroy Literary Center? It looks like it's called Talking to Disaster.
Yes.
Finding Healing Through Poetry.
Yes.
What does that mean? What is that?
What is that? So what we're going to be doing is actually focusing on Hurricane Matthew.
Okay.
And I think for me personally, I've always found that when I'm going through a difficult time, I can kind of lift my own spirit through writing poems about simultaneously why things are both hard and beautiful. Because I think that even in the darkest times, there are moments of beauty and the strength that you see that comes out of these humans that we live with, that in moments of extreme difficulty can be very beautiful and very inspiring. And so what we're going to be doing in that workshop is looking at some poems where other people share their experiences about hurricanes.
Okay.
Talking about our experiences in hurricanes, and then also writing our own poems about our personal experiences. And hopefully connecting on a human level with each other in the room and sharing that common experience. And through sharing that common experience and connecting with some of the poems, finding healing. Because I think that when you've been through a difficult situation, you can feel very isolated and very alone.
Yeah.
And I think poetry is a way that we can find out that other people have been through the same experience and personally connect with that person's words. Because sometimes other poets will say things that we ourselves cannot say so beautifully. And I think that's why poetry can be very healing.
Absolutely. Yeah.
For people that may not be, you know, not everybody is going to be, you know, a fabulous writer. Everybody can write a poem. So I think it's good to hear some amazing poetry and connect with that. And then also not be afraid to express your own thoughts through poetry, whether you're going to be the next Pushcart Prize winner or not. It's very, I think, healing to just get your words down.
Yeah, it is. If I can dig into that, so I feel like we're leaning towards the definition of catharsis.
Yes, absolutely.
And I'm with that, and I'm down with that, and I think there's a place for that, and I think I've ridden that horse for years, the little catharsis horse.
Mm.
But it's been my experience, and I'm interested if you agree or disagree or have any thoughts on it. It's been my experience that if you ride the catharsis horse for too long, for too far, you might not like where you wind up.
I think you do have to be careful that if all you're writing about is your pain in one topic, then you're just going to be dwelling in that pain.
Yes.
Which is completely different than writing one or two poems and healing.
Yeah.
Because if you just continue to
relive
it over and over and over again, then
I notice your title of your workshop is Talking to Disaster. It's not dwelling within disaster.
Living there permanently, setting up a tent in disaster.
Interesting. And you say finding healing through instead of stopping my normal life so I can give in to the pain and stay still for 5 years. It doesn't say that at all. That's interesting.
I'm just hoping, and this one is going to be on hurricanes.
Okay.
I actually started a little poem this morning.
Watch out.
On this whole
thing. You want to share it?
Yeah. It's just a first draft.
Okay.
Many times I sought healing in these wild solitudes, these sandy flats interspersed with windblown forests, riddled with sharp spurs and snakes, yet beautiful as wild, passing uncomplainingly beneath my boots, these windy shores lifted my spirit and calmed my shaking palms. Many days my soul was pressed by the dark parts of life. Oftener my mind was irked by everyday irritations of unkind words, the intrusions of daily chores, the human condition, the air so light and sweet in these landscapes, the sun golden across each unique mossy tree, the loveliness of the hidden colors, nature, the original art. But now my heart aches for these piles of twisted ancients, and then the poem's going to go on and talk about how the landscape changes after a hurricane.
Okay.
And part of, I think, the loss in natural disaster is that we find so much healing and renewal when we go out into nature.
Okay.
Because it seems so permanent that when something happens to our nature, I think it's disturbing on a very heartfelt level. It's more than things just look yucky now. It's like this physical place that I'm connected to on a personal level has now been upturned.
Okay.
You know?
We don't have context. Our context has changed.
Yes.
And we go, what do I mean?
Yeah, we can't go out and take our walk to get away from everything because suddenly the place where you're at is, you know, in the low country, it's so beautiful. There's so many, you know, not just on the beach, but just the park, you know, some of the state parks there and stuff. We can go. I'm a big hiker. I love to hike. Yeah. You know, you can always go and hike out in that nature and find renewal there. So I think that when there's a natural disaster, that place that gives you renewal is suddenly broken. And I think that is very upsetting on a kind of subconscious level. And so I think that's why natural disasters, you know, it's inconvenient, but it's more than just inconvenient. You know, it's more than just your house being destroyed. Your whole landscape has been destroyed.
Right. Okay. Wow. And sparking that, right? So you said that young person in your workshop, poetry was the gateway drug to sign language. So, like, is that what you hope for in these workshops, that poetry will be the gateway to connection or to...
And to healing. To healing. You know, to seeing, oh, other people are also experiencing this loss with me. Other people are also very upset by this loss. And through just kind of saying it loud, other people are also feeling this pain.
Yeah.
And writing about it a little bit. You know, to kind of acknowledge pain and then move forward from that point of acknowledging the pain is there.
Let me ask this question. Why do you think poetry as a craft lends itself to such discussions? Because we could not talk, I feel like we would not talk about carpentry as a craft. I don't think we would sit around with hurricane victims and say, guys, today I want you to really build this chair. I want you to feel this chair. I want you to be with this chair. I want you to forgive and let everything go so you can get out of the way of this chair while you build it. Yet we use that language for the craft of poetry.
Yes.
So what is it about the art of poetry, the craft of poetry?
I think poetry is interesting because it is so sound-based, and it combines this kind of sound world with also meaning and emotion and heart all together in one place.
Because you don't, I mean, I'm sure you make noises while you build a chair, but it's those noises aren't inherent within the chair.
Right, and I'm sure so there's a certain amount of meditation that could be found in the ritual of building something beautiful, like a chair. But, like you said, I think that poetry itself lends itself to creating a space where people can heal pain. I mean, yeah. For example, when somebody dies, the first thing people do is go look for some poetry to read at the funeral.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, our darkest parts of life are where poetry becomes the most important.
Yeah.
And sometimes people... Sometimes it is the only time people go to poetry is when something difficult has happened.
Yeah.
Because they want to hear someone beautifully express how they're feeling in that dark place. They cannot express themselves. And I think that's why poetry continues to be so important.
Yeah.
Beyond just for people that write it, but for actual readers. I think poetry itself gives something to the reader in the form of a human connection and emotional catharsis.
Let me ask you this. If it heals...
Just checking on my friends. Sorry, friends.
No, you're perfect.
Okay. Just make sure y'all...
Yeah, we're good.
Okay. Want to top off with a little coffee?
Yeah! Yeah!
There you go, my friends.
Perfect. Thank you.
Of course.
If it heals... If empathy is created, if it makes the writer and the audience feel better, is that what would designate it as art? Or does art have a different distinction?
I think there's because several definitions of art.
I think, I'm going to quote Paul Allen on this one, and just because you cried when you wrote it doesn't make it a good poem.
I agree with that.
Not to sound like a...
No, absolutely.
Too abrasive, but...
And you have to understand
there's a teaching moment.
Purposes for poetry.
Okay, let's talk about that.
I think there's two purposes.
If we're coming in on intent, maybe the intents are different.
So, just because you write a poem for your own personal healing does not mean that it needs to be a good poem, nor does it need to be a poem for other people.
Yeah, I like that.
Because there's a lot of writing that needs to happen for yourself. Every poem that I write does not need to be published in a book.
That's powerful.
Because sometimes I just need to write poems for what I'm personally going through. Might some of those poems be slow to people? Maybe. Are some of those poems bad poetry? Absolutely. But in that moment, that poem's purpose is not to be great art. It's to be expressing my emotions.
This is powerful.
Yeah. No,
whereas other times, you are writing poems that are there to say what perhaps others could not say themselves about an experience. And those poems are a place for people to go to as a resource to connect with. So I think poetry operates on different levels. You know, sometimes it's just to express our own emotions,
yeah,
and sometimes it's to be more like art.
I like that.
You know, I don't think all poems have to have the same purpose.
And you know what you just said, I feel just hearing it frees me up. Because I don't have any pressure anymore. Because
right.
Now I can write about anything, and I can know that I don't have to share this today.
Right.
I don't have to share this ever. Maybe this one was just for me. Well,
right.
Good for me, I did it.
I did it for me.
Instead of being like, well, I shouldn't write that down because it'll suck and I won't share it with anybody. Maybe that's not the purpose.
And one of the things I always say to people too is sometimes you have to sit down and tell yourself, I'm going to sit down right now and write the worst poem ever. And
bam,
that's going to be just fine. Because A, revision exists. And B, sometimes it's telling yourself, I'm going to sit down and write the worst poem ever, and it's okay. Frees your mind, because sometimes you get so caught up in writing something good that you can't write anything. And it's better to write 10 bad poems that give you one good poem than to try and just write half an okay poem.
I know the listeners can't see what happened, but I just want to say that in this nice sky top restaurant that rotates around the city of Atlanta, 75 floors up, I just threw a fist in the air for that. Let's take a tiny break, just a tiny little tiny break. Okay, we're back. I just ate a whole bunch of dessert.
That's awkward.
We're lounging here at Sundown in Atlanta. I wanted to ask you about the 2016 Carl Sandburg Writers in Residence program you got. What was that like? And was it as glamorous as it sounds?
Absolutely.
Because
it was fun.
I imagine you wearing slippers and drinking tea at least 83% of the time.
Yes.
And just shuffling around, writing poems, or letting poems write themselves. You could take a nap, wake up, the poem's done.
The goats just write the poem for you.
The goats write, because Carl Sandburg's wife was like a famous goat herder, right?
Yes. So within 30 minutes of me getting to the Carl Sandburg house, I was holding a baby goat that had just been born, like that.
Just bit
that
like
hour.
Fresh out of the oven.
Yes.
Wow.
Like, I get there and they're like calling the ranger, so-and-so just had her baby. I'm like, let's go, you know. And so it was really just fabulous. You stay right on the Carl Sandburg estate. There's a cottage there that you stay in. You know, they actually gave me a writing room inside the Carl Sandburg house, a room that Carl Sandburg used to write in.
Is that the one that's like towards the top of the house,
it's
like attic-ish?
Yes, it's the crow's nest. So that crow's nest room, that usually there's like a gate there, and you can just kind of see that there's these great windows that overlook the Blue Ridge Mountains.
Yeah.
They put a desk in there for me, and that was my office.
Okay, so I'm...
It was amazing.
Giddy. I'm losing.
It was
I'm
really
losing.
Cool, because I'm like in his space, in his house, with all his presence there.
Yeah.
You know, writing poems, just drafting stuff. I decided that I was just going to go and just write as many first drafts as I could. And
wow,
then,
cool. Okay.
You know, because revision is for later. So I just went there and just wrote a whole bunch of first drafts and stuff and walked. It's great hikes there. You can hike up on top of the mountain. There's beautiful views. There's actually a favorite rock that he used to sit on. And they put one of his chairs out there for me so I could sit, like, in the same spot in a replica of the chair he used, you know, in his writing spot. And because the Rangers are fabulous because they know, I mean, I knew a lot about Carl Sandburg. I'm very inspired by Carl Sandburg.
Yeah.
And actually, do you want me to read the poem that kind of got me the gig?
Yeah. No, I... show me how I get the gig. I'm super jealous and I want the gig.
So what happens is the friends of the Carl Sandburg picked the poems.
Okay.
And I had sent them a number of my poems from this collection, Lindy Lee poems on Mill Hill.
Yeah.
And the you go and do a reading for the friends of Carl Sandburg. And when I walked in, these two older women who were fabulous were like, oh, we just love your poetry. Would you please read this poem? It's our favorite one of yours. So I said, sure.
You had a couple groupies up there waiting on you.
I did. It was fabulous. It's, I mean, when you're a poet, you don't get, you know, you don't ever get to feel important ever. So, like, when you get, like, 2 minutes of people being like, I love your poetry, you just gotta lap it up. You gotta lap it up.
Okay.
So this is called Blue Pains. And this is based on a trip I took to the Newry Mill in near Clemson, South Carolina.
Okay.
And they actually have some of the original glass that was all blue in a few of the windows.
Yeah.
But in the 60s, they broke all the glass windows out and bricked them up as they went to working night shifts and day shifts and installed fluorescent lights. So the workers would never know what time it really was.
Okay.
Yeah. So, and I think back how it would have been to be in a room with hard working conditions, but having this natural light being filtered through these blue windows. And then you come back to work, and now all the windows are bricked up, and you don't get any sunlight anymore.
Right.
And I think that would be a trauma.
Yeah.
So that's what this poem is about. It's called Blue Pains.
Okay.
Indigo, cobalt, azure, protection from the evil eye or wandering ghouls, cool icy streams, the color of heaven, Jesus's robes, hyacinth blooms. I always loved those windows. 40 years, those blue eyes met mine. A window to the soul. Mr. Stevenson sent the boys up on ladders, smashing, laughing with each rain of blue tears, blue tick, blue bird, blueberry. Shards settled in the grass and shone in the streaming sun like a thousand eyes. Who knew mortar could be spread so fast? By day end, we stood in the fluorescent lights, surrounded on all sides by endless brick. But the debris called to us like jewels to crows. We couldn't help but pick up the shards, filling our aprons with textured glass, then stringing our porches with their blue song. So that is my Blue Pains poem.
Wow.
Which is a fun one. It's a fun poem. It's a fun poem to read.
Yeah.
But Carl Sandburg was very into writing about the working class. He actually was a journalist as well that did a lot of really strong work during the civil rights movement.
Okay.
And so he's a big influence on me because I like to write poems that matter.
Yeah.
And poems that speak to our past and to truth and to history and the way that the world actually was for working class people. I consider myself a working class poet, and I kind of, when you start putting all your poems out, and you're like, oh, I write about working class stuff a lot. I have all these poems about different types of people that work with their hands and work in industry. And I think there's a lot of beauty in their stories to tell.
Yeah, definitely. That's awesome.
So, anyways, it was awesome being in the Carl Sandburg house. We had...
Yeah.
It was such an awesome this place to hang out and be with his spirit and learn. I still learned a lot about it with him. Also got to go do some pretty cool shows. I got to be the keynote speaker at the Blue Ridge Book Fest. And that was filmed and shown on PBS in North Carolina, which was pretty exciting. It was just a great experience. It was just, as a poet, it was just a treat.
Yeah.
Like an absolute treat.
Do you see poetry as a political act?
I think that it can be a way to tell really strong stories in a very simmered down, tight way.
Okay.
Poetry's short.
Because you're bringing art to small town North Carolina.
Yeah.
Like when we describe where Carl Sandburg's
you're in a small
is.
Town.
And then if we were to say, like, is that a red or a blue state? And if we were to say, is that a red or a blue county? And then we would say, like, well, how does the dude at the gas station receive your art? You're kind of taking it to the people there.
that's what I'm into. I think that poetry should be, I like to have poems that everyday people can connect with. I've read these poems in very unusual places where I've had people come up and be like, wow, I didn't even think I liked poems. But, you know, my grandma worked in the mill, and I thought those were really interesting, and they really captured that time period.
Yeah.
And said something about it that's meaningful. Captured an experience that's not necessarily in the history books. I mean, there's so much about that time period. Like, people don't realize that most of the people in textile mills were women and children. You know, this is a time period when most people assume women are working at home. Well, yeah, middle class women were working at home, but working class women, many of whom were often left by their husbands, were working to support the family. The kids were working to support the family. Like, they were all working. You know, I mean, when you're talking about 1920, you know, your 6-year-old is coming to work with you and doing some light work in that textile mill while you're working.
Whoa. Okay.
Yeah, all your kids are there with you.
Yeah.
You know, everybody's going.
I just got a couple more. If I could ask this, what is? I've completely destroyed the placemat in front of me.
That's okay. It will be fine.
There's chocolate. There's mango custard.
There's good food.
And
you have enjoyed it.
It looks like a baby threw a fit in front of me. What is your most tangible fear?
As a writer?
Or a human. Like, however you take that. As an artist, as a writer, as a person, as a woman, as an American.
Like, I think that I'm one of those weird people. I don't like to think about things I'm afraid of. I think it can be paralyzing. I just try and focus on what my goals are. I'm a big believer in, if you put out into the universe your deepest desires and wishes, then that is what you will bring to you. If you put out into the world your deepest fears, that is what you will bring to you.
That's cool.
I like to focus on kind of making goal statements. Like, in 2015, I was like, I'm going to go be the 2016 Carl Sandburg Writer in Residence.
Bam! And then you were.
And then I was like, I want to get nominated for Pushcart Prize.
You know? Then you did.
And then I did. And I was like, I'm going to get my book published. And so I've really been getting into visualizing and putting your wishes out to the universe.
Cool.
And focusing on what I want and what my dreams are.
Yeah.
And then going down the road in a step-by-step, one baby step at a time process that I've been doing since 1994.
There you go.
I feel like maybe I'm getting somewhere finally.
Yeah, yeah.
All right.
And last one, what is the opposite of your most tangible fear?
My dream.
Yeah, like, if you were to define the opposite of fear for you.
Happiness.
Okay. What does that look like?
I think that the ideal life for a writer is to be able to make their livelihood by their craft.
Yeah.
And to have enough time to actually write.
Yeah.
But also to have enough time to, I have a 7-year-old.
Yeah.
I want to hang out with her.
Sure.
You know.
To be a normal person.
You know.
Not just one who broods over a blank page.
Right. You know, hang out with my beautiful daughter, who's a great visual artist. And I love hanging out with kids. I mean, I think that's a joy right there. I love going into schools and helping kids write poetry. Like,
awesome.
I just really enjoy it. You know, some people are like, how do you enjoy going to middle school? I'm like, I love those people.
I have a lot in common with 13-year-olds because the world hasn't kicked them in the face yet, and they're very optimistic.
Right.
I just enjoy laughter and good times, really.
Yeah, it's fun. It's fun. They're good times. And they've been through some tough stuff, and it's fun just to get down in the dirt with them and write some really cool poems.
Yeah.
So I think probably the best case scenario is doing some work with kids on poetry, writing some books, hanging out with my kid, and just having fun doing what I love.
From what I know about you, it kind of sounds like you're living the dream now.
It's been pretty awesome.
Because you do that.
It's
you
pretty
do
fun.
All the things you just described.
It's been pretty fun. I'm having a good year.
That's what's up. Well, Well, it's so good to talk to you. Do you want to leave us with anything? Do you have anything coming up or anything coming out or anything we should visit online?
KimberlySims.com is my website.
Okay.
On Facebook, I have a new author page that I literally started last week called Textile Mill Poetry, and it's kind of cool because I'm sharing poetry stuff, but I'm also sharing like really interesting facts about that era in American history.
Facts.
You know, just really kind of just, this is such an interesting time. You know, people don't really know how people in the 20s and 30s lived in the Southeast.
No, they don't. I don't.
And, you know,
I've been making up my own facts about that. I thought they had, like, buckles in their shoes and everything was in black and white. And the Indians and the colonists were, like, good friends and stuff. I just made that up. I'm just kidding. That was kindergarten. I think bringing facts to the table is something that I've never... It's not terrible. I've never really considered. I haven't considered that in art. But you've made me rethink a couple things about, like, writing biographical pieces from
the heart.
And about people that are real.
Yeah.
That I can research, that I can look up and be like, how can I bring this person to life?
Oh yeah. I mean, I think that's what's so powerful about historical poetry. It's one thing to read about somebody in a history book, but it's another thing to have them brought to life in a poem.
Yeah.
It's very, I think, can be very moving and exciting and inspirational, because there's been so many amazing people and then so many amazing things that we never hear about.
Yeah. You know? That is super powerful.
I think we need that right now.
Yeah, we do.
Well, this has been fun.
Yes.
Thanks for having me over.
Of course. Thank you. Thank you. And thanks for listening, everybody. We will see you next time.
Hey, everybody. Thanks for listening to our conversation. That was Kimberly Simms. Her new book is called Lindy Lee, Songs on Mill Hill. It's put out by Finishing Line Press, and you can find it at finishinglinepress.com. I want to thank you again for listening. My name is Jonathan Brown, and I just put out a new project called the Risk It All EP, and you can find that by thinking about it really hard and hoping that you'll find it.